Hey, everybody, this is DJ Ravenwolf, and you're tuned in to the Best of Hair on KCLA FM 99.3 Los Angeles and around the world on thebestofhairradio.com. And as promised in the studio, we're going to be talking a little bit today about human trafficking, and one of the actresses from the movie Sold is here. It's one of those things that you've heard about probably in the papers and magazines, especially here in Hollywood, with people like Ashton Kutcher and Demi Moore doing their little thing about human trafficking, holding up the little signs where you'll see, in fact, recently I saw Justin Timberlake holding up a sign that says, "Real men don't buy girls." Ignoring the whole fact that Hollywood turns women into sex objects anyways, but, you know. So, in the studio, and she just got married, too. What's wrong with you? Man, also, all you guys out there, sorry. It's the way it goes. Thanks so much for coming on the show. We've got a lot to talk about, a lot of important stuff to talk about. And I've been watching the movie and sharing it with a bunch of friends of mine that feel really strongly. Some friends of mine from Pink Cross and some friends of mine from Las Vegas who are, I guess, have like a lot of firsthand knowledge as to what happens. But for many of the listeners and viewers as well, they hear about human trafficking or sex trafficking, but nobody really understands what it is. Or you know, people think, well, you know, it's all about choices. You know, how can you be so naive and all this other stuff? But they don't really understand. These guys are slick. And I myself didn't realize that a lot of sporting events are targets for these predators. They come in there and they approach women. They approach children. It doesn't matter. And recently we've seen a lot of stuff with high school teachers being arrested for having sex with kids. The society is going nuts. I don't know what's wrong with this, but something's got to be done. So thank you so much for coming on. And for those of you listening, this girl's busy. I've been trying. She was on a long honeymoon, and then we're juggling people coming in. And it's awesome, man. So thank you so much. Tell everybody a little bit about yourself and about this movie and your part in it.
Of course. So, for those of you who understand Spanish or it's easier for you to pronounce, it's actually Maria-Elena, mm-hmm. English Maria-Elena.
You say it better.
thank you. And I am a Puerto Rican raised in Saudi Arabia and Japan.
Wow.
Actually. And so during our travels, because of course it was just cheaper to travel around Asia and Europe than it was to come here for all the holidays. So during our travels, we would see a lot of children out in the streets
Pimping
themselves or with pimps. And I got approached quite a few times. So did my younger brother.
When you say children, about how old?
Well, the thing is that you're looking anywhere from 8 to 15.
Really?
What happens with the 8-year-olds, though, is that a lot of them are taught to have a different type of, to have some sort of a mask.
Really?
So not a literal mask, mm-hmm. but they will say they need candy or whatever it is just to get people's attention. They want some money for candy. And then of course, they'll come.
Wow.
To back alleys and things of that nature. And so it's also been really strange because I've been propositioned while vacationing with my family in front of my parents. And so
really?
My brother. Yes. On the beach in Sri Lanka, he was approached by so many boys his age at the time. He must have been about 10.
Yeah.
And a couple of men asking if he'd work. In Indonesia,
wow.
I was approached. They actually went to my father and asked him if he'd be willing to sell me to them.
Right.
So it's something that's quite rampant in third world countries, and yet this is something that is slicker here. It happens here. It's awful. It's actually a much bigger problem than we think it is.
Right.
But we just don't see it.
Well, you've been around it when you were a kid, and do you find I don't know what it a lot from? There was a time where we didn't really hear much about this stuff. Nobody did. We understood what prostitution was, but we never heard. We saw the girls on the streets, and we figured that's where it was. It's localized. But we never heard the behind the scenes stuff. You never hear about, you know, if kids get kidnapped or whatever, they're found later or they're ended up dead. There was that one girl that was kidnapped, and I think it was here in what's her name? She had the blonde hair. She was kept out in this guy's backyard forever and ever. And it's like,
so it is. It's pretty rampant. And the thing too is that a lot of people don't recognize that as great as globalization has been, mm-hmm. it's also been terrible because it's made it so easy.
Yeah.
You know, so a club owner can literally say, you know, we want three girls from Slovakia.
Wow.
And within a week he gets them, and he has no idea what it took and what danger they were in order to get them there. They just see them, oh, we have workers now to dance in clubs.
Wow.
And so it's pretty rampant. When I was traveling, I was 19 at the time, mm-hmm. and I was in Mexico, and I actually got myself into a strange situation in Guadalajara.
Okay.
I was at the bus station, and I decided to take a cab, and I told them, you know, just give me a place that's really nice but still cheap.
Right.
And so he's like, of course, I'll take you. So he took me to a place called Hotel Nueva York. And it was very odd. It was mm-hmm. cheap. It was about $11 for the night.
Wow.
And I got up to my room. They took my bags. I got up to my room. I got in there, and there were no locks on the doors. And there were strange noises coming out from different rooms. And I heard a girl scream.
Yeah.
And so what happened, I didn't know what to do. And so they had my bags, and I was up there in the room. And so I was still young, so I wasn't really sure what to do. So I actually called my mother from a payphone, and I said, I'm in this place, it's really strange. She said, get the hell out of there, what are you doing? Get out.
Yeah.
And I said, I don't know what to tell them. And she said, tell them that your parents have friends there, and they're on their way to pick you up.
Ooh.
I said, okay. So I went to the front desk, and I said, look, can I please have my bags? You know, I am, my parents have friends that are coming. The woman who was behind the desk freaked out. She stood up on the desk, started yelling at me, and said that I couldn't leave.
Wow.
And so we had quite an argument for a while, and she demanded to know who these people were. I had to make up names, tell them what neighborhood they were coming from, all this stuff. Thank goodness I had read My Lonely Planet before, so I had an idea, you know, of Guadalajara.
Wow.
So finally what happened is that she gave up. And I heard some more screaming in the other rooms. And one of the guys who was a bellhop took my bags and threw them out in the street. Now, Guadalajara is a very busy city. So one of my bags got run over a few times.
Wow.
And I grabbed it, and I was freaked out.
Yeah.
Went to a really nice hotel that I found in the book. And I went there, and I was crying. And I told this guy, I said, look, I don't know what happened. He said, where'd you come from? And I explained. And he said, oh, no, honey. I'm a part-time ambulance driver.
Oh.
He's like, that's one of the biggest sex trafficking rings. And he said, did you get a bus from the taxi stand? Did you get a ticket from the taxi stand when you went to the hotel? And I said, no, not at all. I speak Spanish. I'm not going to let them,
wow.
you know.
Yeah.
I'm not some tourist that they're going to rip off. And sure enough, he said, that's the reason why that ticket place exists, is because they know if there's a woman or a couple of girls, you know, mm-hmm. they go into a cab by themselves, they take down the license plate number, if they're not back within 40 minutes, somebody checks to see if somebody's been dropped off there.
Okay.
Like, you have no idea how many dead bodies I've picked up from there. He's like, he said a few hours, forget it, you would have been gone, whether it was raped and sold into the foreign market, which is usually straight to the US, or, you know, raped and killed. So then he gave me a free room for a couple months. But so it's something that you just don't, you know, you're out, you're traveling, you're naive.
I think that's one of the things the predators are really good at picking up on, is the naivete of a lot of these girls. A lot of them, especially here in Hollywood, will approach a girl, oh, you're really pretty, you know, I've got a friend that does modeling and stuff, photography. They put on a really great show. Come to this studio and all this other stuff, and then pretty soon, you know, the girl's gone. But the other thing is the other side of it is the money factor. There's some people out there paying some pretty good money to get girls to come to either the brothels or the clubs or wherever, movies, to do weird, you know, just thousands of dollars changing hands. And there was a documentary I saw about a guy that went to Thailand, where, you know, it's actually, prostitution is like against the law over there. However, the way you get around it is you just, you know, the girls aren't allowed to proposition you, but you can take them to the hotel room, and then whatever happens is, you know, happens.
I mean, they still yell oil massage.
Yeah.
On the street.
Yeah.
So they still, you know.
Yeah. And then there's been instances where, like you were talking about, how the guys will approach your family. A lot of people will look for families that are impoverished need money, they're starving or whatever, and they figure, well, this is an easy way to make some money. It happens here in the United States. My mom in New Hampshire worked for the district attorney's office, and they prosecuted a lot of the sex offenders, especially from the churches, where that was what they were doing. A minister would approach these two young kids. They come from a really bad family. They needed money for food, and things happened where, it wasn't so good. So it's kind of a diseased culture where, especially right now, with the economy the way it is, people are looking for an easy way out. I've talked to a lot of friends that know wives that are going to the Bunny Ranch and things like that just to make some money because they got nothing.
Well, I'll tell you, the biggest problem as far as children or people who are underage is that men prefer them.
Really?
Them. And they're lied to and say, oh, no, they're 18. Whereas most of these girls, 13, 14, 15 years old. And so what happens is that even a lot of the porn that people see is a lot of girls that are doing it against their will.
Yeah.
And so what happens is people don't know that. So they're inadvertently being a part of this ring.
Right.
And just by looking at porn on the internet. And so what's happened is that there's been a conditioning that this is available, that this is okay somehow.
Yeah.
And so sure enough, men can get a couple warnings here and there, but in general they don't get warnings and they definitely prefer the younger girls.
Well, the younger ones, I think it's easier to manipulate. Plus, the guys are, they're smart enough. Well, they're kidding. I didn't do that. That's ridiculous. Who would do something? It's easy to lie. Not so much when you get somebody who's older and has all their faculties and knows what's going on. I think that's where a lot of the drugs come into play, too. If you keep them all loopy, then, you're dreaming. You can't really substantiate what happened,
Exactly. Now, the good thing is that there are a lot of organizations out there.
Yeah.
And as of now, they're just starting to get on everyone's periphery and say, and they're developing, there are a couple of them that are actually developing programs and apps.
Okay.
Where the girls can call for help. And so it has to be a widespread campaign, literally, just to get it out there. Otherwise, people don't know that there's a way out. They don't know what's wrong. They're vulnerable. They're lost.
When this is kind of a weird question, but let's say, because it happened to you. For those of you listening as well, we do our best to raise our kids, and hopefully they know the difference between right and wrong. But it doesn't take much for some slick person to come along, and throw gold dust in their eyes. We'll make you famous. We'll do all this. When someone's approaching you, there's got to be some kind of signs like, okay, this is kind of weird. You didn't realize it until you were actually in the hotel, which that could have gone either way, is there anything to look for? Is there something that should send up a red flag somewhere early on so that you don't get caught up in this stuff?
Well, I'd say probably go through the regular channels, just make sure that everything is tracked, whether when you're traveling also to have a record of everywhere you've been and somebody who knows your itinerary and your schedule.
Yeah.
And also just to be aware, just have your faculties about them, really.
Let's talk a little bit about the movie. I've had a lot of actors and actresses in here where they're for those of you who don't know, there still is a casting couch out there, which again plays into the whole sex ring thing, where it doesn't take much for somebody to say, if you don't do this, then you're not getting this part and you'll never work. They got connections all around,
Right.
As an actress yourself and attractive, how do you navigate and find somebody that you can trust that, you know what I'm saying? You don't know this guy from the next person.
Right. Well, I'll tell you, I really lucked out because when I first moved here, my very first audition, I actually booked and it got me into the actors union.
Very
good.
SAG. Okay.
And so what happened is that from then on, the only things I auditioned for were things that unionized.
Okay.
And of course, because I went through the proper channels, struggles of having, you know, a union franchise agent and everything,
right.
then I wasn't in those strange situations.
Okay.
And of course, there are tons of those. They're everywhere.
Yeah.
They're on Craigslist. They're everywhere. You know, audition for this music video or this
oh,
and that,
God,
you know,
yeah.
especially the music video thing. And, but I guess it was great because my union put the fear of God in me as you cannot audition for non-union work.
Good.
So from the beginning, I just, you know, lucky angels around.
So it's easier in it to be in a union where they're actually looking out for your best interest.
Definitely.
Okay.
Definitely. Yeah.
As far as finding an agent or anything like that, have you had experience with that? Good, bad?
That has been strange. No, that's all been great.
Okay.
Actually, it's all been.
Yeah. Where, let's say somebody comes out here for the first time. There was a friend of mine, Cody Deal. He was out here, came out from Kansas all by himself.
Mm-hmm.
When you're coming out here all by yourself, I mean, you should have some kind of knowledge as to the business, basically. But, I mean, you got to have some kind of street smarts. You can't just,
exactly.
you know.
That's key, street smarts.
Yeah. And for those of you listening, if you are in Hollywood, if you're planning on coming out here, if somebody approaches you, and especially if you're a woman, and says, "Oh, I'm going to make you famous. Let's take some pictures," which has happened.
Yeah.
Please don't do that. There are, you know, if a talent agency approaches you and they're reputable, do some homework first. Don't just join up with the first person you see. But they usually have their own photographers that they know and that they'll, you know, that they.
And they usually don't approach you too. They're usually so busy managing their
yeah.
own clients. It's a matter of you finding out who they are
yeah.
and approaching them. So it's definitely safer. It's just more legit.
Yeah. Let's see. Okay, so let's talk about the movie Sold. This is
yes.
an amazing film. It's a short film that won some awards with MTV, and it deals with, for those of you who haven't seen it, it's really cool. I'll put the link up on my page. The reporter...
Right. So basically what we did is we came together and we did this short film.
Right.
And it's literally... We were just using it as a pitch to
yeah.
do the feature length. And so we really wanted to address human trafficking, but we wanted to show it in our backyard. And so that's why we chose to mesh, especially California,
mm-hmm.
To mesh, you know, Mexicans with Americans.
Yeah.
So with Caucasian Americans and
sure.
Mexicans. And so the film in itself is in both languages back and forth. It just shows you how easy it is, you know,
yeah.
how the lines are blurred here. And so it was a pitch, but we decided to go ahead and let it go and see how it did in the world. And
sure.
it was great. It did win a lot of awards. And so now we're still following through with getting funding for it to do the full length film.
Man, I hope so.
I hope so too. It's been bouncing around at a few different production companies, and so we may get to the point where we're a little tired of waiting to see who's actually going to do it. We might just end up raising the money ourselves and
yeah.
doing it, only because we feel like it's important. It's not that often where you. You know, I've done a lot of films and a lot of independent films, and they're all, everything's interesting. Everything is
yeah.
a little slice of life, interesting stories, but it's not often where you're actually working in a project where everyone is so passionate about it and you want to take it out into the world
yeah.
because you think it's very, very important. And so that's why.
Have the human rights organizations seen the film, and have they had any reaction to it?
Yeah, well, MTV Exit. MTV has a, it's called Exit Campaign,
mm-hmm.
and it is, and its focus is on human trafficking,
yeah.
sex trafficking, and so they actually we actually won their contest with a film that gives awareness about human trafficking
sure.
and everything, and so we're in talks with them too.
Good.
About doing the film. So it's exciting because you know we're not that far into it, and yet
yeah.
we've already gotten some good attention.
It's a good film. It's really powerful. There's a lot of I like the ending especially, but there's a lot of stuff in there where the basic plot is a reporter goes undercover to check out this thing, and she ends up getting kidnapped herself. She's in the trunk mm-hmm. with this other chick, and drugs and all this other stuff, finding herself in a situation that, you know, I guess sheer human will, survival instinct kicks in, and you know she helps herself.
Uh-huh.
But what was it, I mean, when they approached you with this, because, I mean, obviously it hits home with you. Was this something you guys collaborated together, or did they approach you and say, hey, we want you to do this with us?
They approached me. Mm-hmm. What happened is that they had already had everything written, mm-hmm. and then there's, of course, the feature-length script written, and right. so this was everything condensed into 12 minutes, yeah. basically. I mean, of course, there are a lot of subplots and everything that aren't there. You can't put in 12 minutes. And so that's what it was, and it was there are some great people in the indie world, some great indie actors. Mm-hmm. We have Jesse Garcia, we have Hector Jimenez from Nacho Libre, yeah. We have Andrew Keegan, Fernando Romero, and these are people who I guess, you know, we've been at it for a while now, so you start knowing people, you yeah. know, and so most everybody, I think, in the film was just, we all came in through referrals.
Yeah.
Worked with other people before. And
when you got the script and said, oh, man, I can relate to this, you know.
I can.
Yeah.
I can in a different way, of course, because yeah. I wasn't locked
yeah.
in a trunk or anything.
You shoot nobody. And
yeah.
Sit,
yeah. Of course.
This is DJ Raymond Wolf. We're talking with one of the actresses from the movie Sold. If you haven't seen the thing yet, we'll be posting it on the website. You can check it out yourself. The subject of human trafficking is rather rampant today. It's like I said, a few years ago, nobody heard about it. Now it's kind of a buzzword. It's all over Hollywood. And it, more and more attention is being brought to it. For those of you who, I know a lot of parents that come out here during pilot season to bring their kids into acting or whatever, trying to get them into some of these studios, but again, it's with the gold dust in their eyes. They don't really understand the behind the scenes of things. And if, like you said, you really need to have your head together, have some street smarts. Don't just come in here, I guess, stupid. You got to do your homework. I mean,
right.
if you approach an agency or anything like that, if you look them up on, you got the internet now. Look, check with references. I mean, you got to do your homework. Don't just sign up with anybody who promises you this stuff. Because it's a crazy world out here. How did doing this film affect you? I mean, because obviously you had some experience in the past, but as an actress, emotionally, mentally, how did this affect you?
Right. Well, it took a few days to shake off.
Yeah.
You know, it did, and only because we really. We didn't have that many tricks. I mean, we were literally in a small trunk,
sure.
you know, for 14 hours. And so so psychologically, it, you know, it messed up with me, but just a couple of days, and then I learned yeah. to let it go. But more than anything, what it gave me was motivation, because mm-hmm. I realized that, yes, I had these personal experiences, and I knew that this was something that was rampant, but so many people don't.
Yeah.
And it just sort of reignited
yeah.
that flame in me that yes, people should know about it, and, you know, I need to get involved, too.
Yeah, yeah.
So.
It's really cool. And tell everybody about some of your co-stars. Was it Jesse Garcia? Mm-hmm.
Jesse Garcia.
Yeah, he was one of the actors and producers of the film.
He was, yeah, yeah. He's well-known from Quinceañera, Sundance winner a few years ago. He was really great in that. We have Andrew Keegan. We have Hector Jimenez, who I mentioned was in Nacho Libre.
Yeah.
He's pretty darn funny guy.
Yeah.
He's not funny in this film.
Yeah.
And we have Fernando Romero also, who is more known in the Spanish-speaking world.
Right.
And so it's a labor of love, really, at
yeah.
the end of the day. That's, we all came together to...
That's very cool.
To do it. And actually, also, if anybody wants more information about the film itself,
yeah.
it's the website is soldfilm.com.
Okay.
And we've set up a sign-up area. So if you want to get updates about the film, or if you want to hear about any campaigning, which we may end up doing, that's a great way to be in the loop.
Okay.
Is through there. And then there is also a link to watch
very
the
cool.
full 12 minutes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Online.
It's a great film. If you haven't seen it, like I said, it's pretty powerful. I can't imagine what the full version would be like, because the condensed version really hits you really hard, and you find yourself rooting for the girl. Come on, you know? The bad guys are bad.
Right.
Personally, where can fans check out? Do you have a website or Facebook or something? Or
I am on Facebook. You would just have to do Facebook, /? Maria-Elena Laas, spelled L-A-A-S. And, yeah, so they can get in touch with me there. I do have a few more independent films coming out this year.
Very cool.
So yeah, it's just been very exciting. And then right now I guess you could see me right now a lot. I did a couple of campaigns for Garnier skincare.
Mm-hmm.
So those commercials are running like crazy.
Yeah.
Thank goodness. And
I need some of that.
You do for dark spots.
Yeah, big time.
Corrects your dark spots. So yeah.
That's very cool. So for those of you listening, check out the movie Sold at soldfilm.com.
Mm-hmm.
It's won MTV Awards. And if you really want to check out more about human trafficking, of course, you can Google. There's a lot of organizations out there that have a lot of information. You can check it out yourself. You know, just be aware. There's so much going on in the news with teachers approaching high school kids, ministers approaching young children. Children seem to be the biggest target lately. I don't know what else to tell you. Just have a buddy. Don't walk without. They're just passed a thing now in Colorado saying that the students on campus are allowed to have guns.
Whoa.
It's getting to the point where people are wanting to. Yeah, it was just this morning. They're getting to the point where people are wanting to protect themselves. But, you know, that could go either way, too.
Of course.
So.
Wow. Yeah, and just so people have a little bit, I'm going to go ahead and read a couple of statistics here. I think people should know. They do believe that there are more than 12 million people worldwide that are currently enslaved. And an estimated 2 million are straight to the global commercial sex trade.
Wow.
And just in the U.S. alone, there is about 17,000 people brought into the U.S. annually for the sex trade. And so it's pretty awful. The numbers are staggering.
Yeah.
And yet we just got to get with it.
One of the things I've learned in the porn industry is where we have certain laws here that you can do certain things, you can't do certain things. And the way they get around it is they'll go to countries where those laws don't apply.
Right.
And they'll film there and then just distribute the stuff here.
Right.
There's a lot of loopholes. Right now, my friend Shelley was the one that drove home the condom law that's out there right now. It started yesterday. That actors and actresses on a set, the porn sets they are required by OSHA and hazardous materials and all that, you have to have condoms.
Nice.
The porn industry was balking at this, saying, if you're going to do this, we're going to move somewhere else. And she's like, fine, I'll follow you wherever you go.
Right.
So they were thinking about, instead of Vivid had it in their headquarters here, they're going to set up in Tempe, Arizona.
Mm.
So for those of you listening, if you see a porn company heading up in your neighborhood, you might want to get them out of there.
Well, I'd say, you know, just be an informed consumer, too. I mean, if you can't live without having to, you know, solicit a prostitute, then if you're going to do that, then please make sure that you have your wits about you and you have somebody that is of age and somebody that seems to not come from a very shady position, but seems to want to be there.
Yeah.
Also, and as far as porn goes, same thing. Just be aware as you're surfing the net and looking at porn, and just choose.
Yeah. Well,
how can I explain? I know it's a tough one. It's a tough one.
Yeah, because it covers so many things. If you've got problems doing things like that, you may want to get some help.
That too.
Because
you have a sex addiction.
Yeah,
for sure.
Addictions, like anything else, it can progress into something worse and worse and worse, and by the time you're into it, you're screwed. But there is help out there. My friend Shelley Lubin for the Pink Cross Foundation. If you're involved, if you need help getting out of porn, if you're addicted to porn, there's help there. Please check them out. And there's a ton of organizations out there. I mean, really, it goes both ways. If you're trapped in a situation that you're not sure, if you think, hey, I might be involved in something like this, they're telling me I'm going to make a lot of money, they're telling me I'm going to be famous, and you got all these red flags, get out. It, when in doubt, get out, you know.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
And any last words before you head on out of here?
No, just, you know, get online and see also some of these great organizations. We know that Demi and Ashton's company, or they've got a nonprofit mm-hmm. about it. There's one called Shared Hope, okay. which is amazing. Another one called Not for Sale,
yeah.
which a lot of people are familiar with.
Yep.
Another one called Justice or International Justice Mission.
Right.
Another amazing one. So they're out there, and they're really amazing just to peruse, because they've got a lot of stories, just firsthand
yeah.
accounts of what happens, and it's great. It's great to be informed and educated about you know how this happens, how it goes down, how people get out.
Yeah.
It's fascinating and it's
yeah.
Great, yeah.
It's kind of scary too to figure out when you hear, like, for those of you who don't know, and I was one of them, that the Super Bowl is one of the biggest targets for predators
it
to go
is.
Out there and approach people for sex trafficking.
Big, yeah, sporting events.
Sporting events.
It's easy because you've got so thousands and thousands of people. It's easy to get lost in a crowd.
And the crowd's usually watching the game. They're not paying attention to really anything else. So,
exactly.
Yeah. Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Well,
look, if you ever want to come back and bring the rest of these guys in here, we'll do
yeah,
it. Yeah, yeah.
Let's do that. I'm sure they'd love to.
I think they left you hanging, man.
Yeah.
But, this is obviously a topic that's not going to go away anytime soon. But if you do get the go-ahead for the big feature, you know, let me know. We'll
definitely
do, the, we'll
will,
do this
yeah.
again.
Thank you.
And for those of you listening, you can check out the movie itself. I'll put it up on the website, and you can check it out on www.thebestofitradio.com. And then just follow Melena and just give her lots of love. Man, why did you get married? What's wrong with you, man?
Oh, man, I guess I'm just like every woman on the planet. Everyone's looking for love.
Everybody should just walk the plank once, you know, and that you know.
Okay, well, then.
Oh, good God. All right, guys, this is DJ Ravenwolf. We're going to wrap it up right here, and tune in 24 hours a day on iTunes. The Best of Air Radio is open on the hard rock genre. Just click on that, and the Best of Air Radio is right there on the top. You can't miss us. We'll catch you guys all again right here on the Best of Air, KCLA FM 99.3, Los Angeles. Bye.
Bye.